Hey, lifesavers, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and in today's video, we are going to be continuing our mini series on the endocrine system. So yesterday we learned all about how the endocrine system works, and we learned about the differences between diabetes insipidus and SIADH. Well, today we're going to cover two more common endocrine diseases that often get confused with one another. We're going to talk all about Cushing's disease and Addison's disease. But before we jump into it, make sure you subscribe to my channel, like, comment, and share this video with a friend, and make sure you click that bell icon to turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any of my upcoming videos. If you're having trouble identifying hallmark signs and symptoms and spotting the differences between different endocrine disorders, then I highly suggest that you keep watching. Okay, so let's start with Addison's disease first. So Addison's disease is, in a nutshell, caused by the lack of secretion of important hormones from the adrenal cortex, which is located on top of that right kidney, if you remember that from my last endocrine anatomy lecture. They also suppress the body's immune response, and they help control those stress responses in our body. There's also a shortage of mineral corticosteroids like aldosterone, which help to maintain that electrolyte imbalance, and also a shortage of androgens and estrogens, which play a crucial role in sexual development and also reproduction. So why does this happen? Well, Addison's disease can be caused by several things, including blunt trauma or damage to the adrenal cortex from a tumor or a hemorrhage. But the two most common causes of Addison's disease is from some kind of autoimmune destruction of the adrenal gland itself, and also tuberculosis can actually cause Addison's disease as well. There's also an acute condition called Addisonian crisis, which mimics Addison's disease, but it's caused by something acute, like an acute infection, surgery, or other stressful events. So these stressful events will cause a significant decrease in the production of cortisol and aldosterone. And it's important to note that Addisonian crisis is a true medical emergency, and these patients will need to be treated right away, very emergently. Next, let's talk about the hallmark signs and symptoms that you'll see in a patient who has Addison's disease. So some symptoms you'll likely see are patients who have significant muscle weakness and fatigue, and they'll complain of rapid weight loss due to the really, really low levels of cortisol. They may also complain of having a loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, and oral or buccal mucosa lesions. You'll also see orthostatic hypotension because remember there's a lack of that aldosterone, which typically helps to regulate your body's electrolytes. And the last classic symptom of Addison's is the patient will have a dark bronzy color to them. And this happens because of that direct feedback process that I talked about in my last lecture. So the low level of cortisol triggers and releases another type of hormone called ACTH, or adrenocorticotropic hormone. So this hormone essentially binds to the melanin in the skin, so it will cause a hyperpigmentation, or that means a lot of pigmentation will occur in the melanin. So test results for patients with Addison's that you can expect to find will include an increased BUN and potassium levels from dehydration because of the decreased aldosterone. You'll also see decreased serum cortisol levels, corticosteroids, and also decreased glucose levels. You'll also see a positive ACTH test because of what I just mentioned a second ago with that bronzy hyperpigmentation of the skin. So during the ACTH test, you'll want to give the patient an infusion of a synthetic form of ACTH. And the test will be positive if the cortisol level doesn't rise after that infusion. So what are we going to do with these patients that have been diagnosed with Addison's disease? Well, the first thing you'll likely do is administer cortisone or hydrocortisone to replace the low cortisol levels. You'll also administer fludrocortisone, which will help regulate the sodium and the potassium from that lack of aldosterone that we talked about. And you'll want to monitor fluid and electrolytes very closely by weighing the patient daily and monitoring their fluid intake and output. You may also send the patient down for a bone density scan to check for osteoporosis, because the decreased level of mineralocorticoids, which help to regulate the electrolytes, including calcium. So if the bloodstream detects that there's a lack of calcium, then the bones will start releasing the calcium stores to naturally try and boost the blood calcium levels again from that direct feedback process that we had talked about. Okay, so next let's talk about another common endocrine disorder, which is Cushing's disease. So we said Addison's occurs when there's a shortage of glucocorticoids from the adrenal cortex. Well, Cushing's is just the opposite. So Cushing's occurs when there's an excess or large amount of glucocorticoids that are secreted. Now, this can occur because the adrenal cortex is secreting excess glucocorticoids, or it can happen because the pituitary gland is actually secreting a large amount of that ACTH hormone, which makes that bronzy skin. Because cortisol is a direct feedback response from ACTH secretion. So that means that the higher the level of ACTH is, the more cortisol will be released. Cushing's disease can happen from a pituitary tumor or adrenal tumor, or it can also happen from long-term use of glucocorticoid therapy, which is commonly used for immune response conditions like allergies, psoriasis, eczema, and many other autoimmune conditions. So what are the classic signs and symptoms that you'll want to be familiar with so that way you can identify this disease early? So hands down, classic symptom number one that you're going to want to be familiar with is a moon face. Because of the excess cortisol, the patient's face is going to appear really, really round and full looking. Second classic symptom is going to be a buffalo hump, which is a fat pad located in the upper back. Again, this is from that excessive corticosteroid hormone that's being secreted in the blood. The third classic symptom is going to be muscle weakness and osteoporosis, which you can also see with Addison's disease. Next is the absence of menstruation, or also known as amenorrhea in women, and impotence, decreased fertility, and low sex drive in men. Because remember I said in my last lecture that the adrenal cortex also secretes androgens, which is responsible for the reproductive hormone balance. You'll also see something called striae on the abdomen, breasts, and thighs, which are these very noticeable purple stretch marks. And lastly, you can also see skin changes like infections, acne, easy bruising, and something called hirsutism on the face, neck, and chest in abdomen in women, which basically means that it's excessive dark hair growth. Now let's talk about the tests that you're going to see and perform for patients that are suspected of having Cushing's. So first is the dexamethasone suppression test. So in order to do this test, you're going to give a dose of dexamethasone. If the cortisol level drops in the bloodstream, then that indicates that the pituitary gland is the cause of the Addison's. But if the cortisol levels stay the same, then it's likely being caused by an adrenal gland issue, like a tumor. The second test that you'll run is a 24-hour urine test to check for increased cortisol levels in the urine. You'll also send the patient for a CT scan to rule out any pituitary or adrenal tumors. You'll also check and keep a close eye on the blood sugar level, because it's going to be elevated from that overproduction of steroids. You may also see an increase in the sodium levels and a decrease in the potassium levels in the blood. So what are the treatments and nursing interventions for these patients? Well, the first treatment is going to be to remove any tumors from the pituitary or adrenal glands if it's present, and you want to start radiation therapy right away if the tumors come back malignant. You'll also want to start monitoring daily weights and fluid status like you would with Addison's disease. You'll also want to be checking blood glucose levels really frequently and treating high sugar levels with insulin. You also want to try and avoid any unnecessary trauma or stress to these patients because of the high levels of corticosteroids. It can actually cause delayed wound healing. You'll also anticipate that the patient will need a bone density scan to assess for osteoporosis, again, because the excess corticosteroids will cause calcium to pull from the bones and into the bloodstream. And lastly, you want to place these patients on a low sugar, low sodium, low cholesterol, but a high calcium diet to help supplement the calcium loss within the bones. Hopefully Hopefully now you'll be able to tell the major differences between Addison's disease and Cushing's disease. And make sure you tune in next week because I'm going to be covering another common endocrine disorder, diabetes mellitus, and we're also going to be talking about insulin management. And then we're going to review some endocrine practice questions that you may find on your next nursing exam or the NCLEX. And that concludes the end of this lesson. I hope that you found this information extremely valuable and it made you just a little more confident as you prepare to take your NCLEX or your next nursing school exam. I just want to thank you all again so much, Lifesavers, for tuning in today. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and I help nurses feel more confident, increase their test scores, and retain what they don't remember in nursing school. Speaking of, are you a nursing student or soon to be or ready to take your NCLEX? If so, have you joined my online student community yet? If not, then what are you waiting for? The University community is a complete nursing resource hub all at your fingertips. Inside, you can expect to receive coaching, community, and content. You'll get daily coaching with your mobile mentor, me, Nurse Kelly Tyrell. You'll also receive access to weekly educational videos that you can watch months before they even publish to YouTube. You'll also get exclusive printable digital downloads like worksheets, quizzes, flashcards, infographics, cheat sheets, skills checklists, and more. And if this video helped you in any way, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Also, don't forget to smash that subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss out on my upcoming content. Also, if you can do me a favor and drop me a comment below, let me know where you're at with your nursing journey. I'd love to just say hi and connect with you. Also, make sure you click that share icon to spread the word and encourage a fellow aspiring nurse. And last but not least, when you are ready to take your NCLEX, be sure to check out my NCLEX and Chill review, where I review detailed test-taking strategies and cover every major topic that you can expect to find on the NCLEX. If you want to have that unfair advantage and pass your NCLEX on your very next attempt, be sure to click the link in the description box below. Not ready to end the study sesh yet? Well, you are in luck because if you stick around, you can watch more of my videos coming at you in 3, 2, 1. Bye, Lifesavers.